the Florida Writer Podcast, a discussion about writing and other things.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of the Florida Writer Podcast with your host, Alison Nissen. And today I am interviewing Susannah Marren, which is a pen name for Susan Shapiro Barash. Susan/Susannah, welcome to the Florida Writer Podcast.
Thank you for having me on.
Can you give us a 60-second elevator pitch about who you are and what you write?
Well, under my real name, Susan Shapiro Barash, I've published 13 nonfiction books about how women are positioned in society. And for over 20 years, I taught gender studies in the writing department at Marymount Manhattan College. And those books include a book on female rivalry, female infidelity, 3 studies on the role of wife in America, a book on sisters, a book on mothers and daughters, mothers-in-law and daughters-in-law, second wives, maybe some third wives. And so I've taken my nonfiction research where I've spoken to a disparate group of women across the country, all different ages, level of education, social strata, religion, race, from cities, from suburbs, from small towns. And I'm really looking at how these women feel, what their emotional longing is. And so I've taken that and put it into my dramatic women's fiction. And so that brings us to the Palm Beach series, the Palm Beach novels. And Maribelle Shadow is the third of the Palm Beach novels. And it's about 3 adult sisters, because I'm so excited to investigate how sisters truly feel about one another.
First of all, it's super cool that you were able to take your life's work and turn it into fiction. What was the challenge, though, of moving it from that nonfiction realm to the fiction realm?
So it really is a very different form of writing, Alison. And it takes almost the same discipline and a completely different headset. When I'm writing nonfiction, I'm researching, I'm looking at serious studies and treatises, I'm looking at pop culture, I'm listening to this group of women, you know, as I said, a diverse group of women to understand. And then I take it and I put it into my characters. So again, there's a mother in this novel and her 3 adult daughters, as I mentioned. In A Palm Beach Wife, I wanted to look at the role of wife and what it takes to be a wife in a very rarefied, beautiful town in Florida. And so I'm always considering what real women in real time have told me and then incorporating it into my characters.
I assume that then the characters are very realistic.
They're realistic. They are, I hope, you know, multi-layered. And I think that they underscore what occurs for women in our society, which is that we feel we have to be the good girl. I did a whole study on why women keep secrets and lie for the cause. I did a whole book on that. And so the characters in these novels have lots of secrets.
Ooh, secrets. They can bring a person down pretty fast.
That's the thing. What is survival for women? Even if you live in a town like Palm Beach, which is just so gorgeous and privileged, women still, you know, have to survive. Women still have to pretend. That's just how we're positioned in society.
So tell me about the writing journey. You got started writing academically, and that's almost a whole different field of writing and publishing. Then switching to from academia into this world of fiction, were you able to, did you have an agent? What was your path there?
Well, the nonfiction books, while I am an academic, are not really academic in the sense that they were published by St. Martin's and are really, I would say, in the mainstream. But the idea of doing serious studies in terms of, you know, the interviews where I interview several hundred women per book, but all identifying characters are changed. So the name is changed, the town is changed, or the city. The kind of work is changed. And, you know, say you're an accountant, you'll pretend you're a lawyer for this interview. All identifying characteristics, but the journey, the story of how a woman feels as a wife, or how she feels about her coworkers, or depending on the study, how she feels about being a mother-in-law or a daughter-in-law, very dicey stuff. That definitely informs the fiction, as we were saying, but the research, even if I distill it and make it more accessible, the research is pretty serious. So when I write a nonfiction book, I have stacks of books, I have access, you know, online access to the library. And then I am looking at pop culture, you know, what famous women are like as mothers-in-law or daughters-in-law or wives or friends or foes, rivals, whatever it is. And I intersperse that. So I'll reference all that. When I write a novel, I'm alone. The desk is empty. There are no other books. It's like going into the movies in my own head.
Wow, that's a lot of fun to be able to play with just your own thoughts. I think that's, to me, that's the fun part of writing anyway, is that creation.
I agree with you. It's really, you know, it's the part where you're very happy when you're exploring that.
Yeah, I like to write. I always tell people I like to write at that sort of dawn in the morning when I'm still in bed, but I'm waking up. Like, I don't know if I go into sort of back into a dream state, but I will wake up with an entire what I need to do, like for that day, what my plan is for writing. It'll be crystal clear. And I won't even forget it. That's the best part. It's like, you know, when you wake up in the middle of the night and you have that dream and you're like, oh, I need to remember this. It's like, I wake up and I know it and it's there. And it's like, this was good.
It's very, what you're describing, I think, is very pure. Before all of the day descends upon you. I can appreciate that.
I'm gonna use that. I'm gonna say yes, it's my purity time. And that's where that's I'm right. I'm playing in my playground is my in my that purity moment of the day before the rest of the world jumps in and gets
it
on.
It does,
you,
right? It takes over. It's very hard to be a writer, you know. I have taught so many different classes. And, you know, incoming fresh people, freshmen. And you know, there it's core curriculum and it's shaped and molded. But when I've taught at the Writing Institute at Sarah Lawrence, or when I've done some seminars for writing, we really talk about the process and how everyone needs to have that space and the calm. And it's a challenge in today's world. You know, when I'm always asked, what should writers do? Find time to write. Never let that be secondary. Wow, what a trick that is.
Yeah, it is. And we're bombarded by images and we're bombarded by sounds and you know, people are wearing earbuds and we cannot find the space to just sit and be. And then we turn on a laptop to do our work.
And we're distracted immediately.
Exactly. And it's really bad if all of a sudden your computer freezes and then you get frustrated. And then, you know, it's just becomes this thing. But yeah, I teach fresh people as well. And, you know, every now and then I have students that prefer the pencil and the paper. And I'm in awe that they do, you know, I'll be like, what an old soul.
Interesting, because some of those habits, just what we know, what's pro forma, has really been disappearing. I remember the first year my students wanted to bring their laptops to class. And I said, let's just take notes in this class. Well, today, I don't think one would do that. I think that.
No, they pull out their phone and they are taking notes on their phone. I mean, I remember when cell phones came in to the classroom and you'd be like, oh, no, there's no phones in here. And, you know, now I had a student who completed his final on his phone. And as much as I wanted to be like, you can't do that. Well, everyone else had a laptop.
How about when Wikipedia was one of the sources for one of their papers? And I said, and I, in the beginning, I said, I'm sorry, what's Wikipedia? And then was it bona fide? Was it the real deal? So, you know, there really has been a lot of shape shifting.
Yeah, I need to, I actually need to take points. I think I should put that on my, on the rubric that you take points off if you use Wikipedia. It's like, go to the bottom, find the sources that they used.
Yeah,
it's not that complicated.
And I agree with you. And excuse me, in writing a novel, even if you do research something, it's incorporated into the story that you're creating.
So we've talked about sort of, you know, the bringing the computer in and the Wikipedia, and now there's AI. What do you think about AI and novel writing? I mean, I'm not for it. I'm just going to throw that out there.
It concerns me greatly. I feel that for fiction writing in particular, the imagination and the story that one creates is everything. And I look at writers in awe. I'm in awe when I look at writers in the books that I'm reading, both books that are classic and the writers long gone, and books that are being published today and tomorrow. And the idea that this exists is very, very upsetting to me. I don't see it as expedient. And why should expedience be a part of novel writing anyway? Now, when it comes to nonfiction, I feel equally opposed to it, because while it might bring in research very quickly, I think that the experience of being a researcher, the kind I am for my books and the kind that my students are as my students, is very significant. So the idea that that is now not honored or necessary is really, you know, carries a great weight.
And on top of that, AI hallucinates. It gives us entirely weird things.
So that too, the idea that you're doing it and then you're not even getting the result that's intended, that it can't be trusted, but that's kind of circular. So that underscores why it really shouldn't be the answer or an option. Also, don't you believe as a teacher also, as a professor also, Alison, that what we teach is encouraging, and what students learn is encouraging creativity and the idea of a true thinking process? As teachers, we're here to teach how to think. And that doesn't sound to me, from what I know about AI, as a tool in that endeavor.
Oh, I would agree with that. Just a real quick question, while we're sort of on the topic of gender and students and AI and how the classrooms have changed, do you, as a writer of women's fiction, have you noticed that the women are changing in a sense of, you know, we had our traditional housewives of the 50s and the 60s, and then we had the, you know, the sort of the women's lib, and then we had, you know, the boundaries being pushed and shifted. But I'm just curious about where you see the role of women in women's fiction and how that's maybe changed from writers past.
Well, I read a lot of contemporary fiction to understand what the market is. And also just because I think it's very important that writers support one another, and we should buy each other's books and we should get to know each other. It doesn't happen enough. So when it comes to my fiction, dramatic fiction, I am really looking at, as I said earlier, my research on how women are positioned in society. Has it changed? Well, it certainly changed in terms of options for women in the workplace. But the biggest problem, whether I'm writing fiction or nonfiction, to me, the underlying problem for women in our society is that there's no equal pay for equal work in a capitalistic society. So A Palm Beach Wife, my first of the Palm Beach novels, is about a woman, no spoiler here, but within the first 12, 15 pages, she learns that her husband, a very attractive Palm Beach husband, this woman, Faith Harrison, is in her mid-40s, maybe she's 46. Her husband, Edward, who's just been outstanding among this elite crowd, has lost all of their money. And what does that do to her? And how do women in time, and this is something that really interests me about women of all ages in contemporary American society, how do women survive? How do women save the day? Why are women such pros at plan B? Well, probably because it's a patriarchal culture and we do what we can to get where we are. So that's very important to me in my novels. And I think that women have changed? There are more options. And with options, we find more ways to manage. But women are multidimensional and women are managing. And they're really good at it. So in all of these three novels, I put my female characters of every age. I'm interested in multi-generational characters, you know, novels where there are older women, middle women, and young women. And I'm looking at what they do today in order to be where they need to be. So yeah, women have more agency, but it's not a slam dunk. Agency is hard-earned for women and very important for me to note in both fiction and nonfiction.
Well, Susan Shapiro Barash, thank you so much for sharing so much information with us. How can people find out more about your novels, about your nonfiction work? It all sounds fascinating.
Thank you. Well, they could go to my website, Susan Shapiro Barash, or SusannahMarren.com. It'll bring you to the same website. And I love to, they can follow me on Instagram and social media, Facebook. And I love to hear from authors. So go to my website and write to me and I'll be thrilled and I'll write back.
Well, fantastic. Are you ready to switch to our rapid fire questions?
I'm totally ready.
All right. Do you have any pets?
I do not, but I grew up with two Labradors or three Labradors at a time. My father was, shall we say, very, very interested in Labrador Retrievers, and they were great.
Well, I'm a big fan of them too. Would you rather swim in a lake or an ocean?
Ocean. I grew up on a barrier island on the Jersey Shore.
Oh, how cool.
Very cool. Makes you a writer.
And if you could take a trip to the moon, would you do it?
No. I really want to focus on Earth.
All right. Well, Susan Shapiro Barash, thank you so much for stopping by.
Thank you so much. Great to see you.
You have been listening to another edition of the Florida Writer Podcast with your host, Alison Nissen. Alison out. Ooh, we're all done.
Thank you. Great to talk to you.
Susan Shapiro Barash has written over a dozen nonfiction books, including Tripping the Prom Queen, You're Grounded Forever. But first, let's go shopping and a passion for more, affairs that make or break us. For more than 20 years, she has taught gender studies in the writing department at Marymount Manhattan College and has guest taught creative nonfiction at the Writing Institute at Sarah Lawrence College. For her fiction, Between the Tides, A Palm Beach Wife, A Palm Beach Scandal, and Maribelle's Shadow, she writes as Susannah Marren. For more information about Susan, visit her website at SusanShapiroBarash.com. For more information about the Florida Writers Association, visit us at FloridaWriters.org. Until next time.